Hello everybody and welcome back to another anime thoughts and opinions video. I don't know if this one's really going to be that long. It might actually be on more of the shorter side, at least compared to like the hour plus long videos. And it is quite late at the moment, so I apologize if I tend to sound a little bit quiet at times. I started this at the worst freaking time. I am now trying to clean something on my glasses. Dude, and then I... This is what I get. Alright, so anyways, yesterday's episode was on Space Battleship Yamato, The Quest for Iskandar, which was a crazy endeavor trying to take under 26 episodes in a single day, 25 episodes in a single sitting, that it exhausted me just a little bit. But I was ready for my next anime, and that was a random one, which meant that the next one would be one I would choose from the list. And I chose Charlotte. Now, there's a few things that I'm going to have to talk about before we actually get into the details. But first of all, let's get the usual disclaimers out of the way. Disclaimer number one, this will contain spoilers. Possibly to Angel Beats as well. I don't know. So keep that in mind when going into it. Number two, this is not a full or detailed or professional review, which basically just means I kind of ramble on about it. I kind of talk about it, give my opinion on it, my experience I had while watching it, but there's no script or anything like that, so it is just a ramble video. I may repeat myself, forget to say something, or who knows? There's a whole bunch of different things that could happen. Now, on that topic, in case I don't mention something in this video that you wanted me to talk about or wanted to hear me talk about, say there's something that happens in the show that I didn't give my opinion on that you want to know my opinion on, you can always post that in the comment section and I can respond to you down there. Now, also in the description, you will find multiple links. Link number one will take you to my analyst. Now, my analyst is where I keep track of any and all of my anime-related stats. So you can see all of the completed anime I have over there, nicely organized from TV, film, specials, OVAs, etc., etc. You can see a list of my favorite characters and favorite anime in order, as well as favorite staff in order. You don't have to follow me on there, up to you. Same goes for Twitter, and the main thing for those of you that watch these videos for Twitter is that I post sometimes sneak peeks to the anime I'll be watching next and talking about next. And last but not least, there is also a link to my anime thoughts and opinions, actually thoughts and reviews, YouTube playlist, where you can see all of them in chronological order from upload date. So there's that for those of you that are curious to see any of my other episodes. Alright, so, man, there's a lot to talk about, but at the same time, there's not really that much. I'm trying to think of exactly what order I want to do this in, but, first of all, let me talk about Twitter. The sneak peek I posted for this anime was a picture of a flower, and it was kind of a rough one because I couldn't find any puns that rhymed with or that were similar to Charlotte. I was gonna post like a spider, you know, like Charlotte's Web, but I didn't know if anybody would get that reference, so I went with a flower, the Charlotte flower. Nobody got it, so I guess it was a really, really shitty sneak peek. I couldn't find anything. I didn't know what to use. But anyways, what made me decide to watch this? Since I had to choose this one out of about 120-something anime on the list, if you take apart some of the ones that I can't watch on my own, what made me decide to pick Charlotte out of all of those? Well, a few reasons, actually. Number one, I've had my eyes on Charlotte for a very long time. In fact, if I pull out my piece of paper here, this is my list. Can you hear it? This is my list. If I go back to the first page and we look on this page. Sorry, that's the wrong side. Okay, if we go back to the first page and we look on this page and we read, because I write these in order from left to right on the first line, then you go to the second line, etc., etc., right? How you'd normally write in English. So that means that the ones that are higher up on the list are the ones that I wrote down first. Charlotte is the, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Charlotte is the 9th anime written on the list, which means it was the 9th anime that I wrote down to keep track of. to put onto my watch list. And one, two, three, four, five of those anime, of those nine anime, have already been completed, have already been watched. So, yeah. I actually put Charlotte on the list myself. Now, it has since been recommended to me by two different people in the YouTube comment section. But this is one of those anime that I had already had on the list because I put it on there myself originally. The reason for that is not because of my own knowledge of it, but because it's one of those anime that somebody told me about years ago. And they were like, oh, Charlotte, you know. But I wasn't really, that was kind of after my whole anime downfall. So I wasn't exactly in the mood to go and watch another anime. But I never forgot about the name Charlotte. And here we are. And I finally watched it. So I was actually going to watch Charlotte about a month ago. I don't remember what anime I watched instead, but when it was time, when I was going to figure out what anime I wanted to watch next, this was before I had the random pick. This was before I had the bowl of anime. And I think I only had like maybe 30 anime on the list at the time. So I didn't know what to watch, and I was like, I'm going to watch Charlotte next. But then something else came up, and I ended up watching something else instead. So there was actually the possibility that I could have watched Charlotte like a month and a half ago. And I mean, at least we got around to it now. I mean, everything on this list will be watched at some point. It's just a matter of in what order it's going to be watched. All right, let me put this away now so that it didn't distract me anymore. So what is Charlotte? I don't know. I went into this. Okay, now this is, here again, I have to talk about the blind thing. When I go into an anime for the first time, I have to explain whether or not I have expectations. Now, going into an anime blind means I have no expectations because I don't know what the anime is, period. Now, I didn't really know what Charlotte was, so I technically went into it blind on that side of the story, but I did go in with two expectations. Expectation number one, I went into this anime expecting to cry. Expectation two, I went into this anime expecting to love it. And there is a reason for that. Because this is the work of PA Works, a studio, and it's also produced by Key, which basically means this is kind of where I started with, because my very first anime that I ever watched officially was Angel Beats, which was also something that was developed by PA Works. So this is, I went into this knowing that, and so I went into this expecting to bawl my eyes out. And that's why on Twitter, my, what the hell do you call it? My summarization of my thoughts, and I have to put really, like, small opinion on the anime I just watched, because Twitter has such a very small limit on character usage. So I put Angel Beats V2.0, but this is about a comet. And then, there you go. So, watching this literally feels like I'm just watching Angel Beats again, for a few different reasons. And we'll get into those reasons, of course. But let me talk about something right away, the rating that I gave this, which is actually something I usually talk about later on in the video. The rating I gave this on Analyst was an 8.5. So, that's quite a high rating. But the significance of the 8.5 is that that is the exact same rating that I have for Angel Beats. So I gave Charlotte the same rating as Angel Beats. And that's because I was kind of torn in a few places on this. I wasn't sure if I wanted to go above 8.5 or below 8.5. Now, it was not going to be below an 8. I knew that from the start. So it was not going to go anywhere below an 8. But was it going to be an 8? Or was it going to be like an 8? I think originally I was thinking 8.7 works, but then the ending. So I had to drop the score down a little bit, and I ended up settling with 8.5 because I couldn't say whether or not I enjoyed this more than Angel Beats or not. So I said, same. Man, there was a lot that I was not expecting here. So I guess let's get right into it. What is Charlotte about? Well, Charlotte is about kids and their peepees. Hmm? What was it? Did I say something strange? Sorry, let me elaborate. Charlotte is about kids and their puberty powers, which I did not expect going into it. Essentially, there are kids during the stage of puberty that have special powers, essentially. And one of the confusing things is that absolutely everyone has a different power, though that's very unique. And we'll get into some of the powers in particular here in a little bit. For the first six episodes, I was like, oh, okay, this is kind of a neat idea. I guess it's just going to be slapstick at a school of kids with superpowers. Good shit. And then it'll end on episode 13, because this is 13 episodes in length. However, oh, of course, it wouldn't be that simple now, would it? Oh, man, screw this. Jeez, I cannot stand it. Like, why does anime always have to do this? It always does this. On its own, the idea didn't really interest me. I wasn't really interested in the idea that these characters have these special powers, because the first, like, five episodes are really bland in that regard, if you look at it as that on its own. That's not to say that it's bad, because to me, what this really seemed like at first was the genre that this is rated as is a supernatural drama, or a drama supernatural. Two different genres, obviously. Supernatural, obviously. Okay. Drama? No. At first. I had no idea how this was rated as a drama genre anime at all. Because there's zero drama in it. At first. Literally, I get almost halfway through the series and there's no drama whatsoever. All it is to me, and this is what I was thinking that it should have been, is I thought this should be a comedy. Supernatural comedy. Because the first, like, five episodes or so is literally just comedic episodes with comedy on top of comedy on top of comedy. And thankfully, the comedy is actually pretty good, so that's not a bad thing. That's why I was really confused. And I was like, okay, is this all that the series is going to be? Because how is this a drama if it's not a comedy? Or, excuse me, if we're just going through all this comedy throughout it. Things definitely take a darker turn in episode 6, and at the end of episode 6, and then episode 7 is when things take a darker turn, and then obviously when you reach like episode 9, that's when shit hits the fan, and you're like, oh yeah, this is a drama. This is definitely a drama. And that's what saved the series for me, in my opinion. If it would have stayed with that comedy, just a superpower school with kids with superpowers, for 13 episodes, I would have still enjoyed it, because the comedy did make me laugh out loud a few different times. So I would have still enjoyed it, but it probably would have garnered like a 7.3, maybe 7.5 if it was lucky, rating. So what saved it was the ridiculous plot twists that they threw into the series halfway through. A little bit later than halfway through. In fact, most of the thick story stuff comes out right at the end. Unfortunately, but I actually think it was kind of paced relatively well. Like, if this was a 26 episode long series, they would have really had to have done something different, because I don't know how they would have dragged this out in 26 episodes, with the exception of maybe the very last episode, episode 13, which I could see that being dragged out for a couple episodes. I'm both glad they did, and I'm actually disappointed with it. Like I said earlier, I kind of hinted that the ending was not satisfying to me. And I guess I'll get this out of the way first, as well. Did this make me cry? No, it didn't. I had a stage 2B trigger, which I still haven't officially shown what my 5-stage system is. But once again, in case you haven't watched any of my other videos, I'll give you a brief rundown. The stage system is how I rate the intensity of how much I cry during an anime. It goes stage 1, stage 2A, stage 2B, stage 3, stage 4, stage 5. The higher the stage, the greater the intensity. The lower the stage, the less the intensity. Stage 2B basically means that tears left the eyes and rolled down the cheek, but not that much. Stage 2A means that my eyes were full of so many tears that I can't see anymore. And stage 1 simply means my eyes teared up a little bit, but nothing left the eye socket. And stage 2B was triggered by something that happens in episode, well, it happens in episode 6, but you find out about it in episode 7, so, do you? Yeah, I think you do. You find out about it for sure in episode 7. That, I think, is where my stage 2B was triggered, and it only lasted, like, a half a second. I was like, really? And then, pff, there are the tears, and then they're gone. and I didn't really get tear up that much. I think I had a stage one near the end of the series, and that's about it. Because surprisingly, this doesn't have a bad ending. I was expecting it to have a really shitty ending. It doesn't. It doesn't have a bad ending. It doesn't even have a bittersweet ending. I guess it's supposed to be have an element of a certain character, but in my opinion, it's supposed to be a happy ending, and it ends happy. Why am I not satisfied with it? Well, we'll get to that, because it deals with the thing I cannot fucking stand in anything, not just anime. I've already complained about it in like three of my other anime thoughts and opinions video, but I cannot stand this bloody thing of characters losing their memory. It is the... it pisses me off so much. It annoys me. It's not that it's a bad idea. It's just that I don't like it. And I don't like it enough that it can soil an ending for me. That's why Charlotte's ending is kind of unsatisfying for me. But I have about a million things on this list I haven't even talked about yet. You know, screw me. I need to talk about some of those related things there. Okay. So, the story centers around a small group of characters, mainly. You've got, of course, the supporting cast and secondary and stuff like that in background. But you'll mainly be focusing on four characters. Well, technically five. And that's the small group of friends, which is Yu, who is the main character. He's a dude. Wow. A male? Can you believe it? In an anime? No, me neither. Whatever. And he has the special ability to control other people for 5 seconds. Now, even from the moment that this anime started, I thought that was really dumb. I was like, that doesn't make any sense. What is the point of being able to control somebody for 5 seconds? See, obviously it's revealed later on that he has an extended version of his power that he doesn't know about. That's what actually makes it slightly more interesting. Of course, because he doesn't know about that originally, he's using his power for stuff that a boy of his age would use that power for. Not only does he use it to cheat on tests and get into really prestigious classes, but he also uses it to do lewd things, like look up female skirts or take control of a female and look at her own breasts for a minute. You know, shit like that, right? And he also uses the power to trick someone into thinking that he saved their life so that he can catch a date with them. You know, crap like that. Which, I mean, that's kind of amusing, and I think most of those scenes are kind of amusing. I can see myself doing one of those. The saving thing, not the lewd thing. Why would I do that? Who would ever think I would do something like that? Bloody hell. God, it's not like I had... Anyways, he ends up meeting a few characters as he's part of a certain school, and he meets up with two other characters, and one of those are... Shit. Now. We'll just name her Now, which is her first name. Now. That's such a weird name to try and say. N-A-O. Okay. Now. God damn it. Get over here now, Now. Like, seriously, do they not think about... Well, obviously they're not speaking English, so why would they think about that? Dumbass. Who is by far my favorite character in the whole series. She's going straight on my favorite characters list on Analyst when I'm done with this video. And she is also accompanied by a adjust the glasses every time you see him on the screen character, who also has an ability. So both of these characters have an ability. Somehow they're from a different school, yet they somehow know about Yu's existence, which, you know, is kind of supposed to be like, ooh. But it's all explained, obviously. Their powers, however, Now's ability is that she can go invisible. She can disappear, but only to one other person. See, now this is actually something that I think is really interesting about all of the main abilities that you learn about in this. But everyone's ability has an advantage, but it also has a disadvantage. So, for example, what we're led to believe about Yu's ability is that his disadvantage is that it only lasts 5 seconds. But there's more to talk about with his abilities later. Now's ability is that she can go invisible. She can disappear, but the disadvantage is that she can only disappear to one person, whoever she's in contact with. She can't disappear. So she can disappear, like, if she was standing in front of me and I was with a group of my friends, she can disappear to me, but my friends are still going to be able to see her. Something like that. So she can't do anything mischievous, really. And Mr. Glasses, his special ability is that he can apparently his ability is he can teleport, but really the way that they show it in the show is that he's actually able to run at super speed, which I'm not exactly sure. There is a difference between moving fast and teleporting, but I guess the idea is that he's always going in a straight line. So he teleports, but he travels. So he doesn't just open a wormhole and pop up, you know, across the yard. No, he has to travel from point A to point B, but in a straight line. And because of that, you get a few amusing scenes with him. I think he's kind of the comedic relief of the earlier episodes. He's always got blood spraying out of his head, you know, in comedic fashion and stuff like that. So he's a pretty fun character to watch. I mean, of course, another character comes along later on who has a very curious ability. Her ability is that of essentially how the fuck do I explain this? The way that they explained it in the show is that people with these abilities, usually there's a high chance that siblings will have abilities as well. So this other character that comes into the show has her own ability, which is the ability to become possessed by the dead. What an ability. And she doesn't even know that she has that ability. Like, she's not even aware of it. Her sister, on the other hand, who is dead, she has an ability as well. So when she takes control of her sister's body, she can use her own ability, which is the ability to throw fireballs, essentially. She has the ability to create fire. I thought this was really interesting. The fact that you have one person acting as two different powers, even though one of the powers is kind of useless, the power of being able to be possessed, because that's not really a useful power now, is it? Obviously, it's used too extensively when her sister takes over, but yeah. Now, Yu actually has a little sister himself named Ayumi, and she is the most adorable character in the show, which is what triggered Stage 2B, because for some reason, because this anime had to go and be an anime, that's why it triggered a Stage 2B. And nobody really knows at first that she has a power, and obviously you don't learn until a little bit later that siblings have the possibility of having their own ability, and it's revealed what her ability actually is at some point. And the way that these characters, I was curious at first, like, how they tracked down Yu, and how they tracked down other characters. Well, that's also revealed that they have another fucking ability user who has the ability to detect other ability users. Every fucking time this guy walks into the student council room, I can't help but start laughing and giggling. And it's not because of him himself, it's the music. For some reason, that music just makes me laugh every fucking time. But this guy, he's got long, droopy hair, and he always comes into the room soaking wet. Of course, again, you do learn later on about all of this, why. But he just points at a map, and lets a water droplet hit the part of the map, and says, "I've detected a user that has this ability," and then he leaves. And then the music stops, and then he comes back in another scene, and there's that music again. I don't know, it's just that, for some reason, that music makes me laugh every freaking time. Okay, now they actually say in the early, I think, now actually explains that his disadvantage is that he can only detect people when he's soaking wet in all of his clothes, but that's actually not true. So it doesn't seem like everybody has disadvantages, because I don't know what his disadvantage is. Now, later on, you meet more ability users, like a person who's able to travel through walls, but the disadvantage is that it's extremely exhausting, so even traveling through one wall will tire him out, big time. There's another user who can put people to sleep, but the disadvantage is that after they put someone to sleep, they themselves will fall asleep, you know? So it really reminds me of what I loved about Mirai Nikki, in that everybody had their own future diaries. And all the future diaries had advantages and disadvantages. That's the same sort of thing here. Everyone has an ability, and they all have disadvantages. They're all different, and they all have their own advantage and own disadvantage. And there's, for example, there's also a character that can erase memories, but it's never explained what the disadvantage of that is. There's a character that can, now this one's pretty big, so I won't I won't mention exactly who I'm talking about, but this one is kind of the turning point of the story. But there's also a character who can time jump, who can go back in time. But the disadvantage is that every time this character uses that power, they lose a part of their vision. So at some point, they'll lose their vision completely, go blind, and they can't use the time jump ability when they're blind. You have to have both eyes, apparently, for it. I explained both eyes because something also happens relating to those eyes later on. So in terms of the story making everybody have a different ability, while that's interesting, like, it's really unique, in terms of the story, it didn't really make much sense to me, because it's actually explained what Charlotte is at some point. And this is also learned, this is also kind of one of the mini plot twists that you get later on. Charlotte, at first, when I went into this, I thought Charlotte was the name of the girl. Like, I thought, because she's plastered, now, she's plastered over all of the Charlotte, you know, content. So I was like, okay, so this must be just a story about Charlotte, and it's going to be a romance, right? No. Charlotte actually does have a relation. Charlotte is about a comet named Charlotte that passes by like every 75 years or something like that. And when it does pass by, it leaves behind particles that, when essentially ingested or infected, or they infect people, and these people develop these abilities during adolescence, which is the whole story right there, right? And I mean, that's really cool, but the thing that doesn't make sense to me is, in a real life situation like this, why would the comet consistently create different powers every time? Because as far as I'm aware, there is no such thing as two people with the same exact power. And if they have similar powers, they're similar, but they work in different ways. So I don't know. It's kind of confusing to me, honestly. Maybe it's the idea, like snowflakes. Every snowflake is unique, you know, uniquely different to a different snowflake. I don't know how true that is, but that's just what you hear, right? So maybe it's a deal like that. So I'm 27 minutes in, and I've kind of been all over the place with this video, and I realized that. That's mainly because I've been trying not to talk about the story, like, in order, the big elements. So I've been kind of all over the place just talking about the characters and talking about the whole elements that you have to take into account with... Fuck. Get... What the hell? How the fuck did that happen? That you have to take into account with ability users and stuff like that, and the way that all their abilities are different. So I'm going to take this time now to actually talk a little bit more about the story itself in the plot twist that comes. So if you really don't want spoilers, then this is where you need to leave. All right, so a character is... now this I did... I literally... I'm not even kidding. I fucking docked 0.1 rating off of Charlotte. Because, once again, it's another really annoying instance of the killer cold. Oh, I fucking cannot stand this! And this is a cliche. It's totally a cliche. I only see this shit in anime, and I've seen it so many ridiculous amounts of times that they get hit with a cold and suddenly they're on death's bed. Fuck off. A character ends up getting a cold and is bedridden, because that's what colds do. They make you die. For a couple days, or for like a day, and it's Ayumi, who is Yu's little sister. And I mean, this girl is so much fun to watch. She's cute, she's adorable, she's funny, I love everything about her. And when Yu goes back to the student council back at their school, which, by the way, the school he transferred to is the school where they keep track of kids with abilities. I believe the staff are also in on it. I don't remember for sure. I don't know if that was ever explained. But they learn about the new location of an ability user known that has the ability to collapse or whatever. And if they find out that it's actually in the dorms, which means it must be somebody that's sick. And that's, you know, home from school. Because it couldn't be an adult, because adults don't have these powers. So they end up going back, and of course Yu has some inclination that it might be his little sister. And this is where things really take a turn. This is where Charlotte like flips up on its ass. It's suddenly not the show that it was prior to it. Because first of all, Ayumi is meeting with like a couple of her classmates. Are there three of her classmates? One of them is really quiet. She's got purple hair, and at first I thought that this girl with the purple hair was the ability user. So I was like, oh. They make us think that it's actually Ayumi, but really, it's because her friends were there, and so this purple-haired girl, because you even get to see her in a scene earlier on where she's sitting at the desk in her classroom, and she's got this really weird look on her face. But she's got, like, this really disturbed look on her face every time, Ayumi's around. And I was like, okay, well, maybe she's the ability user. I don't know what the ability of collapse is. The characters in the show, like now and stuff, think that maybe it has something to do with destruction. I was thinking it had something to do with, like, collapsing, like, just... you know, flopping over onto the floor. Like, either they had the ability to cause someone else to collapse, or they had the ability to collapse themselves for whatever reason. Not that that would make any sense at all. And unfortunately, Ayumi decides that because her temperature went down, even though Yu said to stay home, she ends up going to school the next day. Which makes everything go ass end up, because she ends up meeting with purple hair lady, and I was like, oh, okay, they're gonna start talking. Ayumi has a certain classmate that's, you know, admires her, a boy that she already rejected him, but he's still trying to fall in love with her, and I think they're relating to this boy. This purple lady says that she's hardly a lady, she's a kid, she's like a kid. But I guess that she's in love with the boy, and because the boy's in love with Ayumi, he's not paying any attention to Purple Hair Girl. So she's kind of very jealous and very angry. So, okay, they're going to have a little fight. You know, Ayumi's, you know, going to try to defend herself. Well, maybe the Purple Hair Girl throws a few punches. No, the Purple Hair Girl pulls out a box cutter and extends the blade like 6 ticks in total, enough to literally stab and kill Ayumi. And I was like, what the fuck is this? What the hell am I watching? We're 6 episodes in and this is happening now? What the hell? That totally caught me off guard. I was never expecting something like that to happen. One bit. So, in first plot twist, bam, throw it. Throw it at me. She ends up chasing Ayumi into a corner, and Ayumi becomes really distressed and she becomes really frightened, and that's when she starts to glow. And that's when the whole fucking side of the school just collapses. Basically, she does have the collapse ability, which I wasn't expecting. Again, I didn't think I thought they were making it too obvious. Well, they made it too obvious to make me think it wasn't the case, but in turns, it turns out it was the case in the first place. And, I mean, holy shit, you get to see, like, that whole fucking side of the school just... So, essentially, the collapse ability basically means you get to create... You are the center of an earthquake, because you just crush everything around you. Unfortunately, the danger of it is that you could end up killing yourself. And I think the end of the episode, you get to see Ayumi fall, and there's like rubble falling around her, but that's all you see. You hear her screaming, and you know, and then you end up now, and you and all of them, they're running up to the school because obviously they know something's wrong. And they're trying to find Ayumi, and there's just Yu's digging through the rubble. And then he ends up getting smucked on the head by a piece of rubble, and that's where the episode ends. And I was like, oh my god, holy shit. Okay, so there, I guess, well, in the next episode, he's probably going to wake up in a hospital, because that happens a lot in what I've watched. And we'll see what happened. You also get to see hints of characters you don't know, by the way, in that scene. And episode 7 comes around, and he does wake up in a hospital. And he immediately sits up and says, Ayumi, is she all right? And then, bam, reality hits you hard, bro. Because no, she's fucking dead. What? And I was just, my jaw was, it was on the floor when this scene went by. I couldn't believe it. And literally, in the span of like 30 seconds, you see the funeral, and you just see him starting to mope about it, and you see him blaming himself. You see him like realizing he never, you know, he never did anything for her. You know, it's just, it's such, I was like, what the hell is this? No fucking way. I trusted this anime. You know, I went into it expecting to cry, and then I go in 6 episodes and nothing happens. I guess technically 5.5 episodes and nothing happens, and I'm like, okay, it's not a dangerous anime. Then suddenly it decides to flip overboard and become dangerous. That totally pissed me off. I was so angry that she was dead, and she's dead for a few episodes at least. Because this is created by whom it's created by, it seems like everything they work on has a happy ending. So that might be one reason why I didn't cry very hard, and I only hit a stage 2B, because I ended up telling myself repeatedly underneath my breath, she'll be back. I don't know how, but she'll be back. And sure enough, she does come back. But the way they do it is actually kind of interesting. There is no, you know, she just poofs back into existence for no reason so fucking ever. And you go through, I think the next episode or two focuses on you becoming very mentally ill because of what had happened. And he ends up going off on his own. He tries to run away, and he just becomes a cock, using his power for bad. And he almost gets into doing drugs. But that's when Nao makes one of her first fucking badass awesome scenes. Because the moment he's about to go, I don't know if it's drugs or not, but he rolls up like a piece, like a receipt or something. And I don't know if he was like going to snort cocaine, or if he was going to, I don't know, create a joint and smoke it. I'm not exactly sure what drug it was, but it's hinted at that that's what it is. And the moment he goes to do that, out of nowhere, Nao just appears and she kicks it out of his hands. And I was like, fucking yes. Like that made me so happy to see his ass get beat by my favorite fucking character in the show. And obviously she reveals that she has been there by his side the entire time after he ran away. She's just been using her power to stay hidden from his view. I wasn't expecting that. I honestly wasn't expecting that. And I think it's awesome because they have, you know, she basically is the one that saves him from this illness. She is the one that keeps him from turning into a slob. And that's amazing. Oh, man, fucking awesome. I love that so much. For some reason, that's just, that's one of my favorite scenes. If not, that's my favorite scene in the whole show right there. He ends up coming back, and then episode 9 is where everything goes to shit. I never explained about Nao's brother, but to briefly explain it, Nao has a brother, and I never explained the whole idea why they have to keep their powers hidden. So the reason they have to stick together and keep their powers hidden is because of the deadly scientists, who are very dangerous, actually. Basically, I don't know if you want to refer to it as the government or specific groups of people really want to test upon kids with these abilities. And unfortunately, Nao's brother was one of those people, and she was in one of these institutions. She ended up escaping from it. But her brother didn't get to have that lovely fate. So her brother's basically gone insane. And I think episode... I don't know if it's episode 8 or if it's... I think it's episode 8, where you actually get to meet a certain character, blind character, who is the lead singer of a band, who just so happens to be the same band that Nao's brother is a fan of, or was a fan of, and that Nao is also a fan of. And this whole episode is awesome. I think it's probably one of my favorite episodes in all of Charlotte. But they end up successfully managing to calm Nao's brother down and start bringing him back from his insanity. He starts to remember and recognize people, like his own sister. And I thought that was really beautiful. In fact, that's actually something I should have mentioned at the beginning. If I had to explain Charlotte in one word, it's beautiful. Like, this whole fucking thing is beautiful. And we'll talk exactly about everything I think is beautiful about this anime near the end. But episode 9 is where they actually go to a concert. Nao and Yu seem to be, they're getting really close. Like, they might not admit it, but you can tell these two are totally going to bang at some point. And I was like, wow, this is beautiful. They're going to a concert together. You know, they're so cute together. They make a perfect couple. And then out of fucking nowhere, Yu just gets this random memory or two and flashback, and he breaks down and passes out as he goes through this quote-unquote dream as he's passed out, where he basically relives memories from his past. Somehow, it's again, it's something that's really awkward, because it's in the same, it's sort of the same as Higurashi, but at the same time it's sort of not, and I'll explain why, or try to explain why. But this whole scene is like the biggest plot twist in the history of plot twists, because you actually come to learn that Yu used to be in a massive underground facility, and he was himself a test subject, as well as Ayumi, his little sister, and, where it is revealed, his big brother. And you get to see all of these characters, and you get to even see one character who looks very familiar, because it's actually a character that we, as the viewer, know already. They didn't do a good job at hiding that. I don't know if they were trying to hide it or not, but I noticed it right away. So, because it's actually kind of revealed later on in a certain, almost like a way, but it's really obvious. But regardless, this whole scene is fucked up, because you've got these security, like, soldiers walking around with submachine guns, aiming them at the children every time they need to go somewhere, whether they have to go to eat, or they have to go back to their rooms, or whatever, or their cells, rather. And essentially, there's this whole revolt going on in this facility, where these characters are working together, and Yu is going to basically go to rescue his brother, if possible, so that his brother can initiate his own ability to unfuck everything. Now, where is his brother? He's locked up in basically extra security. Think of it like the equivalent to solitary confinement. And the reason for this is because his power is so ridiculously deadly that, or so ridiculously powerful that they have to lock him up that way. Okay, this scene is so awesome. They drag Ayumi off, basically to test on her, I'm assuming, but it's all off screen. And using his cell, and this whole scene is awesome, because all of a sudden, just everything starts shaking, the walls start cracking, everything gets fucked up, the alarm system goes off, you know, there's an alert on the intercom and everything, and then the doors are locked and everything is just white, and I'm like, they totally fucked with Ayumi, and she's the one that caused this. That is amazing. I loved that scene so much. So everything kind of gets screwed up, and there's this desperate attempt to escape. There's this this scientist that actually isn't a bad guy. He's actually there to help, and he ends up releasing Yu and tells him everything. And that's actually where you get to learn about Yu's ability. His ability is the plunder ability, which is very fucking powerful. So essentially, for some reason, Yu's family is ridiculously overpowered. His older brother has the ability to time warp. He has the ability to plunder, which I'll explain what that is. And Ayumi's ability is to fuck everything up. The plunder ability is probably the most powerful ability of them all. That's why he's the most powerful ability user. It's the ability to essentially steal other ability users' abilities. That's why he doesn't take control of people for 5 seconds. That's why it's so short. It's so short because it's intended for him to take control of an ability user's body, and then 5 seconds pass, and he comes back having absorbed their ability. The downside is that that person loses their ability, so it's not like he can copy the abilities onto himself. No, he literally steals them. He literally plunders them. And the whole escape scene's really fucked up. You see people get killed. You hear people get killed. Like, you know, they're just blasting their machine guns into these children. It's awful, man. Fuck this. Can you not be depressingly dark in any anime? Every single fucking one has to have some dark thing. Even the non-dark anime have to have something dark in them. But regardless, he ends up freeing his brother, and his brother time warps. And you end up learning that it's almost like a Higurashi thing, where he ends up going back, and he tries to figure out how to save his family and how to save his friends and how to save ability users. But he fails over and over and over and over again. And he keeps going back over and over and over and over again, you know, until he gets it right. But he notices that he's losing his vision each time. And thankfully, coincidentally, he ends up figuring it out all on the last try. So unfortunately, he goes blind, but everything is mostly finished. He ends up having, I think, a secret facility built all for the ability users and finding a vaccine, because the abilities are actually diseases. That's where you learn about the comet and you learn about Charlotte itself and the diseases that infect people and how people get these abilities and why. Everything is explained. You know, there is a reason why these kids have these abilities. So it's good. That's actually good, because there's plenty of shit that won't explain anything. And they'll expect you just to think of it, you know, on your own. And regardless, whether or not you think that that's a good or bad thing, I guess that's up to you. I personally like to have things explained, unless it's super obvious, to figure it out yourself. I don't like it when things leave, you know, questions unanswered. That's actually something I really dislike. And because of this, he's able to actually, when you learns everything, he's actually able to absorb the power of his big brother, and he obtains the ability to time leap. And he goes back and he saves Ayumi. So that's how Ayumi comes back to life, essentially. Now, I said it doesn't make much sense earlier. What I meant by that is that Yuz shouldn't have memories. He shouldn't... Okay, all right, actually it is. It is sort of explained, because he has Yu and Ayumi memories wiped by the character that can erase memories. But he has their memories wiped of him, so that they don't remember that they have a big brother. Yet, Yu remembers the whole escape sequence at the facility. He should not remember that, because that happened. Technically, it never happened. It never happened one bit, because they went back in time. See, the time travel is so screwed. In any story that has time travel, it makes no sense. And for the exact reason I just explained. It doesn't make any sense that he should be able to remember that. Unless, for example, I mean... The gears of time actually do reverse, and the people do reverse with it. So I guess that could mean, I don't know, I still don't accept it. I still think that doesn't make any sense personally. But whatever, that's the way it is, so we're going to have to deal with it. Actually, we talked about just about everything. The conclusion of the show, like the last couple episodes, you do focus on an ability user or an ability wielder syndicate. Essentially, there are multiple syndicates around the world. Most of them want to do for bad. Most of them want to test on these people. But you end up having this kind of mini war with, I'm assuming, what is supposed to be the American syndicate. The only reason I say that is because the leader speaks English. Relatively good English. There's actually quite a bit of English speaking in this show. Most of it, while isn't actually, like, it's not levels of, like, Terror and Resonance bad, where, you know, report to Air Force Police. You know, it's not that really bad. You can tell an Asian is trying to speak English. It's actually pretty good, but you can still tell that some of the voice actors, not all of them, I'm not actually sure on some of them. Some of them may actually be native English speaking, but some of the characters that speak English, you can tell it is an Asian voice actor or voice actress trying to speak English, but they do a really good job. So honestly, it's not that bad. It's not cringy like in Terror and Resonance. Oh man, that's so bad it's good over there. So that was pretty good to see. But yeah, there's this mini war that ends up going on. I'm not going to go into too much detail. But apparently, you know, two of the characters, including Now, end up getting kidnapped, and it's oh man, one of the characters sacrificed himself. It's the only real death in Charlotte that you get is a particular character. It didn't cause any issue for me because I wasn't attached to his character, but I did think that what he did was kind of beautiful. He kind of sacrificed himself for Now in a particular scene, but again, I'm not going to go into too much detail about that. We're going to talk about one last thing here about the show, and it's my most disappointing part, and that's the ending. And then I'm going to talk about why I think this fucking anime is so beautiful. And then we're going to bring it to an end. This video is kind of shit, I can already tell. Like, When I'm done with the video, I know when it's a shit video, and for some reason I'm just doing a really shit job on the Charlotte one. It's because I tried to explain elements of the show without going over the story first, and I think that kind of screwed me up a little bit. So hopefully you don't hate me too bad for this video. But, okay. In the conclusion, basically what after they escape the syndicate and everything is supposed to be okay, they realize that shit's going to only get worse. So how can they keep this from happening? Well, a vaccine has been made for the disease. So in the future, no more people are going to be born with this disease, right? Or that is that is what is implied. But what ends up having to happen is Yu decides he is going to, with Nao's help, obviously, because Nao's the one that told him to do it, but on his own, because he has the ability to absorb abilities, he is going to go around the world and absorb tens of thousands of abilities from people so that he can absorb every power, therefore no power wielders will exist anymore, and he can bring an end to it so everybody will be safe. He does that, and I don't like it. It's scrounged down into one full episode, the final episode, and you just see him going around to all these different places around the world, just absorbing people's powers. And what is cool is you get to see some scenes of like different powers. Like there's a guy that has a high jump, there's a girl that can heal, you know, and a whole bunch of other stuff like that. Because not everybody uses their abilities for bad, obviously, but of course some of them do. But the reason I don't like this is because number one, he goes kind of insane. Though that does make sense. That is part of the story. I do accept that. It makes sense. And what keeps him going is this little flashcard booklet that Nao made for him. That he forgets everything. But he remembers that this is important. So he keeps working. That's what keeps him going. And then again, this is why it's so unsatisfying. Finally, by the end, he absorbs the final, the very last ability on the planet, which is courage. And then they try to trick you into thinking that he dies because he gets shot with like 3 bolts from a crossbow. But then out of nowhere, fucking, you know, Deus Ex Machina happens and his brother comes flying in. You know, like, of course he does. Because this is one of these anime, so shit like that's going to happen. Not that I'm disappointed. And he wakes up again in the hospital bed. Right next to him is Nao and everything. I'm like, okay, end it here. This is beautiful. They're going to, you know, they'll end it with a kiss on screen, and then it'll be like, oh man, I've missed you so much, I love you. But no, his memories are gone. He's a potato. He's nothing in his brain. And they don't even explain, does he still have all of his powers? Does he still have every fucking thousands of powers he absorbed? I don't know. I don't know if it was ever said. But no, he doesn't remember Nao, and you get a couple scenes with Nao explaining some things to him. And then they end it. They fucking end it like that. Of course, it ends happy. You get to see everybody together, all happy, you know, smiling and cheering. But I really hate it when characters lose memory. I really fucking hate that. And that's how it ends. And you don't even... Nao and you never once share a kiss. Yet they are clearly in love at the end of the show. It may not be a romance, but this is the first anime in existence that I have ever watched where the two love interests never share a kiss once. I was so disappointed. Like, I was disappointed that I couldn't be depressed. Come on. What the fuck? And that's why the ending's disappointing to me. Now, there is a special, actually. I saw an analyst. I saw that there's a special episode. I don't know what it's about. I didn't look into it, so I don't know if it continues the story or if it fixes the issues I have with the ending. I don't know. I will put it on the list, and I will watch it at some point, though it's not a priority right now. So, unfortunately, I guess I'll just have to sit not knowing for the time being. And that's, you know, that's really it. That's really the biggest problem I have with Charlotte is its ending. There's a few other things that are kind of more minor annoyances throughout the series. The fucking killer cold. But there's a shit ton I didn't talk about, and because this is a really bad and poorly put together video, there's a lot that I didn't really mention. So there's a lot that's going to be missing, which is why I say in the comments section you can always ask me shit. I'll give my opinion on it, particular what you're looking for down there. But now that we're done with the story stuff for Nao, I want to talk about why I think this anime is so beautiful. Now, right away, when I noticed something about the music, specifically the lyric music, like the opening, the ending, stuff like that, specifically the opening, I was like, okay, this opening is very familiar. And I said, holy shit, I swear to God, I've heard this voice somewhere. And the first thing that popped in my head was Angel Beats. It sounds exactly like the same person that performed the Angel Beats opening. I went straight to Analyst, because one of the good things, one of the convenient things about Analyst is that it lists, when you go to an anime, it lists like all of the staff members, and so it'll list who performed the opening and the ending and all that kind of stuff. And I went to Charlotte, and I went to who performed the opening, and I clicked on her, and then I looked at all, it has a full list of everything that she's done. And you see, in there, she has not only performed for Angel Beats, but also things like Air and other things that I've seen. So that would definitely explain why I knew where that was from the moment I heard it. And oh my fucking God, the opening song is so relaxing. And the ending song, oh my good Lord, could anything be softer and more relaxing than the ending song to Charlotte? There's actually a couple ending songs. I don't know what one I'm talking about in particular, but I'm sure it's the one that you guys would, if you've heard it before, you'll probably know the one I'm talking about, because I think the other one's not as soft. And it's not just the opening and ending music. It's the music in the anime itself. It's extremely relaxing. It's not dramatic. It's not over the top. It's not all that memorable in some places, but when it is going, it's extremely calming. I love the music from this anime. On top of that, let's talk about the visuals. Good fucking Lord, is this anime beautiful. Not in just visuals, but in terms of background as well. The actual set pieces, and fuck. Hold on, something got stuck. The actual set pieces and the, landscapes. There you go. That's what I wanted to, say. The landscapes. For example, when you see, like, the city or the ocean, when they show that, I don't think I've seen anything more beautiful in any of the other anime that I've watched so far. When they show the sky and they show all the stars, it's fucking amazing looking. It is so good looking. All of the character designs are great, in my opinion. Oh my God! Now has dark frost blue eyes. Marry me. Please. I just want to marry those eyeballs. I love the way this anime looks. I love the way it sounds. I love everything about it visually and audio-ly. That's not a word. And that's another reason why I put the rating up as high as I did. But at the end of the day, the reason it mirrors Angel Beats is because I couldn't decide whether or not Angel Beats I liked more or less. And because they're so similar, I mean, they're so similar to the fact that you see Angel Beats in Charlotte. Like, you actually see fucking Kanade in this anime. Not in person, but you see her on screen. And I was like, boner, when I saw that. She's my very first waifu, and I will never forget how Angel Beats made me feel. And that's what kicked off anime for me originally, so I owe a lot to Angel Beats. And Charlotte brought back a lot of those memories. Because the art style is not the same, but it's very similar. The music is not as action-packed or upbeat, but it's still very similar to me. And the beauty of it is still very similar. I don't know. I really like Charlotte. I really do. So we're going to bring this video to an end with that conclusion. Charlotte is really good. And I really did like it. Even though I did a really shit job on making this video. I don't know. There you go. That completed Charlotte. The next one is a randomly drawn one. Now, in my Magnitude or Tokyo Magnitude 8.0 video, I did draw it on video. But I didn't mention what it was. I don't know if I should do the same thing now, because I'm not actually sure if I want to. But I might as well, just to keep things going. I'm trying to think if there's anything else in the meantime that I wanted to talk about relating to Charlotte. God damn, I almost feel like I should redo this video, but we're already an hour in. That's an hour of talk. That's how bad about it I feel. I don't know. Hopefully people will at least pass it off as being acceptable. I'll try to do a better job in the next video, whatever it's on. All right, hold on. One moment. I just get these mixed up a little bit. And I get in there with my fingers and I toss them around and squish them around a little bit more. Oh shit, Charlotte's actually still in here. See, when I pick an anime myself, I have to go back through this entire bowl of anime and find it. I have to go by one. So if I were to pull out Charlotte right now, how funny would that be? I won't, but because there's over 100 pieces of paper in here. All right, here we go. What did I pull out? Fuck. I dropped it on the floor. One moment, please. Oh, shit. I can't watch this one. Fuck. Well, that was underwhelming. Trying it again. There are a couple anime, not too many, but there are some that I can't watch. The one I just pulled was an anime that's actually not finished, so I'm not watching it yet. But it's on the list for when it is finished. Alright, here we go. 3, 2, 1. So I was a little nerve-wracking. And then I dropped it again, you fucking idiot. Oh my Christ. Are you serious? All the fucking anime. This is the one I pick? Okay, well, I'll give you a hint. It's got an exclamation mark in the title.